In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. In these hallowed words, we uncover the profound truth of our existence, crafted in the very image of the Almighty. This likeness is not merely a physical resemblance, but a trifold harmony encompassing our body, soul, and spirit. These three elements are woven together with divine intention, creating a symphony of life that mirrors the triune nature of our Creator. In a world fractured by sin, the unity of the body, soul, and spirit can only be restored through the life-giving power of the Holy Spirit. Without this divine intervention, we are but shadows of our intended selves, yearning for the life only God can provide through Christ's redemptive work on the cross. Join us as we pursue deeper and further into this truth. And no matter who you are, from the intellect to the one who feels they know nothing at all, from those who know exactly what it means to be a child of God to someone who is just curious, I invite you all to join us. Walk this path with us as we explore the divine harmony in nature, in the heavens, and most importantly, within us, seeking to understand how our lives are interwoven with God's eternal plan. May our time together be a journey of revelation, drawing us closer to the heart of our Creator, where we find our true identity and ultimate fulfillment. Alrighty, now that we're all settled back in, I want to welcome you and welcome anyone else online right now to the second day of the Harmonizing the Body, Soul, and Spirit for Divine Worship Seminar. I'm Josh Snyder, and I thank you for joining us once again. And if you didn't catch the first part or day number one to this series, I would challenge you to go back and listen to that, get caught up, and then move right along with us, as some of this stuff may not make full sense if you did not already hear what we started off with. Day two, let's not waste any time as there's much ground to cover. Let's jump right into today's objective, the objective being the alignment of the soul tracks. We're going to run down and discover how we can align who we are on the inside, the three tracks of the soul, with God's design. These three tracks were made to follow whichever master has rule over it. Why is our soul and the direction of it so important to give a full day exclusively to discovering how we can align our soul's tracks with God's plans? Well, the body is temporal. The soul is not temporal. As we discussed yesterday, the soul and the spirit, though different, they were both designed to be eternal. The soul, however, does not equip us for eternal life in God's presence. Having a soul does not mean that we have the spirit that has been regenerated by God. This mortal body will decompose. And those of us in the family of God, those of us who have been regenerated by the Spirit of God, our soul will move on, our spirit will move on, and we will receive new bodies in glory, in eternity, in heaven someday, and a reunion of these three essential parts of humankind, and I believe mirrored images in a lot of senses of how God is, who God is, what He is. All of this will be reunited someday in a perfect sense. Maybe you've got a decision that you have to make to break off a relationship that you know you shouldn't be in. That cuts to the soul. Maybe you've been unfaithful in your marriage. These things cut to the soul.
Maybe you're conflicted about some of the food that you're feeding yourself. These things must be considered and internalized. Otherwise, we will not take action on the external or on the outside. And so this is why I believe the soul is such an important component to us, practically speaking, here today. So for the first session of today's part of this seminar, let us begin to dissect a little bit deeper the three parts of our soul and the alignment with God in the perfect symphony. I'd like to share an example here in just a moment of a piece of music that may help you understand what I mean a little bit more clearly. Our soul was meant to react and correspond with God. Our soul, who we are on the inside, was meant to walk in harmony with God, and then truly within our spirit and our body. But when it is out of balance, when we are not listening to the voice of God, we will find discord. The next session, we'll discuss a little bit more on the discordant notes and identifying these notes within us. But today, I would like to focus a little bit more on how things should be. After all, when they train people to identify counterfeit bills, they focus more predominantly on the right thing or the real thing. And then after some time, we'll get some training on the wrong thing, the counterfeit. But one must first understand or know how to identify what is wrong by understanding what should be. I want to show you that there is a symphony within that we are called to work out. And our soul, who we are on the inside, is a crucial part of this symphony. As we stated yesterday, 1 Thessalonians 5:23 makes a distinct difference between the body, soul, in spirit, when it states, "May God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you wholly, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless unto the day of our Lord Jesus Christ." Let me take this moment now and play just a piece of music, and I'm not saying it is perfect, because it's made by human hands, and the particular human hands that made it, we all know, is definitely not perfect. Again, I'm not perfect either. I'm not throwing stones at good old Justin Bieber. But check this out. When I watched this, it gave me not only inspiration, but it made me consider a key fact. And we'll come back and discuss that key fact here in just one moment. Check it out. Can I have you three play that? You guys follow that? Everything's staccato now. Wow. Again, not perfect, and we didn't watch the whole thing there, but there is beauty in what we just saw. There is harmony, melody, rhythm. We see all three of these at work. Justin Bieber apparently has a headset on and probably is listening to some sort of melody in his ear to tell everyone else around him what they should or shouldn't do. In the same way, we should have the Spirit of God guiding us so that we can command or tell our body what to do. We are designed to make praises to God. We are designed to be like a harmonious symphony to our Creator. And we cannot be if we've got rogue instrument players off doing their own thing, not listening to the conductor. And though God gives us free will, we within our will must hear His will and say, body, soul, listen to the will of God. Just like JB was this little illustration or picture that we can look to, listening to whatever he was listening to keep him on track. We must listen to the leading of the Spirit of God to keep our souls on track. When our soul is aligned with the Spirit of God, the music of our life, the orchestra of our life, and then in unity with other brothers and sisters of faith can be such a beautiful thing. I don't know about you, but there was a time in my life that I did not know what it meant to walk in freedom. And maybe I didn't even know what it meant to be free. But when the Spirit of God came to life within me, though I'm not perfect, I'm still in a cursed body, a body that will die, and I still have the desires of my flesh, the appetites of this sin-cursed world that I must fight against, I now have had my eyes opened to so much more. And my spirit will never, never die. I am now a child of God. And in this place, my soul is now in a place where it can listen to the Spirit of God and tell my body what to do. And if I listen to the direction from this harmonious train, I will continue to be harmonious with everything that I do outside of my mind. I can think about this all day long, but if I don't put it in action, if I don't let my soul guide my actions outside my mind, then I will be a hypocrite. Then the Spirit of God is not fulfilling its perfect work, its work within me. Or you, if that be you. So let me challenge you. Command your soul to listen to God, and let that soul not be the driving factor, but let it be pulled by the Spirit of God and not the body. Alrighty, welcome back, welcome back. Let's jump right back in. Session 2, day 2 of the Harmonizing the Body, Soul, and Spirit for Divine Worship Seminar. Thank you for coming back. Thank you for continuing to watch online. Today and in this moment now, we're going to be talking about the identification or identifying the discordant notes. Because much like music was designed for a purpose, and there is good music and there's bad music, and no, I'm not referring to genres. I'm not referring to different flavors of that. I'm referring to like the framework in which music is set within harmony, melody, and rhythm. These basic fundamentals that make up music, just like music was designed with a purpose, and we can tell when it's a bit out of whack, quite bluntly, we were designed with a purpose. And if we are trained to any degree on what should be, we can look in and listen in and hear that there is something not right when there is a note that is out of tune. And I pray that up until this point, there's been some insight on what should be. And now let's talk about what should not be. James chapter 1 verse 8 states, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. What does it mean to be double-minded? Well, first, it ties back to who we are on the inside, this tracks of the soul, the mind, the will, and emotion of who we are. But when we have a double mind, or we are hypocritical in the ways in which we think, what we say, and what we do, we will rarely ever play in unity as God designed us to with our lives. I know in the last little session, we listened to a piece of pretty powerful sounding music that Justin Bieber orchestrated with his voice. But let's listen to a couple of small pieces where this was not the case. Without further ado, here is some discordant notes, and you can tell me if you hear the discord within the way in which these songs come together. Listen in.
Sorry, I'm nervous.
Just come.
Okay.
Major Lee, the baffled key, composing, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You see the light, it's so cold, it's so broken, hallelujah, yeah, hallelujah. Ooh, ooh, yeah.
Oh boy. Though we don't have time to go down the rabbit trails of music theory and discussing, you know, who was off where and why did that sound bad, every one of us, probably even those who don't know anything about music, listened and thought, that doesn't sound good. Which then begs the question, if I may be so blunt, how do those kids' parents let them out of the house with that voice? It was not very hard. It is not very hard for us to identify notes that are in discord against God's design tune. Especially if you've got just a little bit of knowledge. The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy, understanding. First off, we must be awake to God, alive to God in a very real sense in our spirit. And from that point, we then begin to study, to search out truth. And when we have at least somewhat of an understanding, we can identify notes that are in discord like that. Very similar to how you just heard the discordant notes within that piece of music or music pieces that we just listened to, if you want to call it that. And I say that as kind of a blanket statement because we all are going through different things. Different questions are arising, and though some things are not as clean cut as we feel like they should be, some things are not as clean cut in the scriptures, some things are not as black and white as we desire them to be, the Spirit of God and His Word can and will give direction for all matters of faith and the practice of it in our life. For me, I travel around the country. I've moved from my home state of Montana to now Georgia State, and I find that in the decision-making process, though none of those decisions were based on Scripture or very literally based on Scripture, those decisions very much so were based on the guiding of the Spirit of God. Why am I saying this? Well, the discordant notes that would try to cut in are like other voices that would tear our focus, our soul, who we are on the inside, away from focusing on the right voice. And in those decisions that I had to make for myself and my family, if I was not sure beyond a shadow of any reasonable doubt, in faith, like if I did not have the ability to look in and say, I believe based on who I know, the God I know, and how He operates, if I did not believe that me taking my family across the country or me traveling around the country to do what I do was not the right thing to do, I would know. Very obviously, no. And I say that because I've had many days where there's no right or wrong answer, and there's a decision that must be made. And I know the right decision after some time of prayer and submission to the Spirit of God. Sure, it takes time sometimes, but the notes that would pull us away do not align with His Spirit. And just like when I play a guitar and the notes are not aligned, or we just listen to some voices being lifted together, if they do not align together, cohesively unify together, harmonize together, the same thing happens to your spirit or your soul, who you are on the inside. The same thing happens. And we maybe cringe back in a physical way. Or maybe we just know deep down within, as they say, your gut feeling, though it's not always right, but if it's submitted to God, that gut feeling was created for a reason. We can follow and trust that voice. Not only have a voice to trust and anchor our lives in, the Spirit of God, but a voice that is contrary to the notes that are in discord against him. Simply put, this is how we need to identify the notes of discord. Looking to and through the Word of God, always in prayer, and when things aren't as black and white as you think that they should, submit yourself to God. He will bring direction. And sometimes the answer is wait. Sometimes, if it's not so clear as, you know, yes, you shouldn't be in that adulterous relationship. Yes, you shouldn't consume that much. Yes, you don't need to be putting that into your body. Yes, you don't need to be saying those things. Like, there are certain things that are very clear in Scripture, and we should not kick against those things. But when things are not as clear, maybe it's a directional question. God, would you have me move my family across the country? Submit yourself to that Spirit, His Spirit. And within your spirit, your life-given spirit, that will tell your soul which direction, physically or mentally or spiritually, that you must go, and give direction for all matters of life. Another verse in Psalm states, "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." That is what His Word, in a physical sense that has been written down for us, copied out thousands of years, and preserved. That is what His Word does. And that is what His Word, the direction of His divine Spirit, this is what it can do for us when we're submitted to Him. Alrighty, this is the third and final session for day number 2 of the Harmonizing the Body, Soul, and Spirit for Divine Worship Seminar. I'm getting a little pumped up. I don't know about you, when considering how some of these things might be worked out in my life and how they have been worked out in my life. It's actually an amazing thing to sit back and to think about what God has done and then to consider what He will do. It's not about a bunch of rules and the keeping of them and looking right, though, when we follow God, when the literal God of the universe indwells us and our spirit is alive, we will desire to follow Him because He has the best ways. He has plans that are far greater than anything that we could ever concoct within ourselves. Let's jump right into this third and final session for today about the crisis and turning points, or crisis and tuning points. As you've probably noticed throughout this seminar, I have used typology and music to align within a sense with what I'm trying to say and to convey to you in this very deep, spiritually charged message. But in all reality, what does tune us? In the times in which we get out of tune, misaligned or misguided in our own thoughts and desires and wills, or maybe we're following a different voice, a voice that is charged by the flesh or the world or the devil, how do we realign ourselves to the Spirit? There are many things that we can do. Just getting into the Word of God, opening up a Bible, studying it out within proper context and understanding that there are things in there that are do's and don'ts for our benefit. But then also following Him, trusting Him through consistent prayer, consistent meditation on who He is and what He does and what He desires for you, and keeping your eyes and ears open. But after all of that, or along with all of that, what does God do, or what can God do, and what has He done to tune us to the tunes that He would have us play? There's a couple of different directions we can go, and we're going to touch on, I think, both of those directions here. Hebrews 12:6 makes a statement about one of these directions, and where it says, "To whom the Lord loveth, He chasteneth, and scourgeth every son in whom He receives or delights in." This is a verse that references to the discipline of our God. And just like a father disciplines his son or his daughter and takes away things that they would otherwise have, or puts them in time out, or whatever the case might be, or whatever utility that we use to show our children that this is not the right direction, whatever decision they're making, I would say that there are some things in life that happened to us because we made the wrong decision. And God says, no, not that way. And there's a reason why. There's deeper reasons beyond your comprehension. My ways are above your ways. And so there's going to be some discipline from our God. And this can look like many different things. I remember there was a time when I was a teenager. I was a Christian. I knew who God was. The Spirit of God regenerated my spirit. And yet I was running from God in many senses and following after my desires, my will instead. And I knew that I was a child of God because in that process of me running from the Spirit of God, I felt His conviction. The chastening, as this passage would put it. And God uses instances in our life to call us back when we are running from Him. Not only was there internal repercussions, the Spirit of God saying, you know, you shouldn't be here right now, and making situations that I would have enjoyed in my flesh by Himself, making me actually or physically sick to my stomach in those situations. But also, there were physical consequences that came because of my bad decisions. Whether it was sexual sins or me sneaking around and vandalizing our community, there are many different things that come to mind and repercussions from those things that had to take place inside and outside. And I thank God for them. Why? Well, to whom the Lord loves, He chastens and scourges every son in whom He delights. Just as I'm tuning this or turning these knobs to tune this guitar, if this guitar could speak, maybe it would tell you that that hurts. It doesn't like that pressure. Don't touch me. I am my own boss. Maybe if every single one of those strings were alive in the sense that we are alive, maybe they would kick against me as well and say, I know better than you. Isn't that how we get sometimes with God? Our soul crying out, I know what's best. I like what feels good over here. I want to do this. My will be done. And not your will be done. Jesus was the perfect example. God in flesh, laying down His life, praying in the garden before He did so, saying, Father, my body doesn't want to do this. I'm about to endure the greatest pain known to mankind and take on the sin of the world. But not my will, not what I desire, not what this body desires. Your will be done. God uses these crises at times in our lives to tune us because we are out of alignment with His plans, with what God would have for us. And again, His plans are better than our plans. Oh God, you changed my plans, you wrecked this, you messed this up for me. No, if God changed your plans stunk. Your plans were not good enough. Oh, that's kind of harsh, Josh. I don't know your situation, and I'd love to individually maybe engage about it if there's something deeper about it all, which does bring me to the next part or the next leg that we'll discuss for the remaining little portion of this. God does use situations like crises and trauma to tune us up by chastening us, by disciplining us. But also, there are times when it's not discipline. Here's what I mean by that. Romans 8:28 states, and we know all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to His purpose. God has a purpose in everything. And yes, sometimes He uses life situations and the Spirit of God to convict us, to tell us, you're not where you should be. I need you to go this way or that way. But there are other times when we are not apparently doing anything wrong in that moment, but we still suffer. Why? Why? I don't have the answer for every single example that anyone could bring up of why God allowed this. At least I don't have specific answers. But I do know, and I've seen this time and time again, not only in my own life, but in so many other people who I know and love around me, who can testify that those times in which they went through things that seemed unfair, the times in which they lost a child early. I lost a brother of mine years and years ago to this freak of a virus that traveled up his spine and shut his brain down. None of us could have detected it without a spinal tap. Why did you allow this, God? I don't really know the specific answers, but I do know that in those times, God tuned me. God used those situations, the good, the bad, and the ugly of my life to tune me. In those times where we were pretty positive we're doing the right thing, but it's still really hard. These strings, again, if they could talk, maybe you would hear them say, "I'm doing the right thing. Why are you tightening me up? Why is this pressure so hard? Why am I so tightly bound together? Why am I having to work with these other strings?" All the questions that we might ask in a physical way to God about our life. God, why have you allowed this? Why does this hurt so bad? Why am I working at this job? Why have you put me around all these people that don't love you? What? And the list could go on, and there are different answers for these questions. But in a broad sense, God can and will use every single one of these examples, everything that we could go through, for His glory and for our good. For His glory and for our good. All things work together for good to those who love God. If you are in the family of God, you fall into this category. And to them that are called according to His purpose. Those of us who are in the family of God, if we are trying to work out His plans, His principles, His precepts within His word, we can trust that He'll guide. And that even when things that are perceptively bad come, that those things will tune us. We must not kick against those things. We must not lose faith when the master says, "No, a little tighter. No, you're a little too tight. Let's loosen up a little bit. Let's loosen up." How many times has God had to tell me, "Loosen up, loosen up"? In the times where God is realigning misguided notes, there is reason for it. Again, I don't know all the answers, but I do know that inevitably those notes, when played after some time of realignment, will come out far more beautiful than anything that we could put together within ourselves. After all, He made us. And I would bet that the person who makes this kind of guitar, the manufacturer or the designer of this guitar, knows that guitar inside and out and could tell you everything about it. I'm not the designer. I didn't design this body. And yet, I think I can control everything. We are just instruments within this vast, vast orchestra. But I thank God that He is working out His harmony, His divine purpose within a fallen man like me. And will within every single one of us. We don't grow bitter when He begins to tune us and shape us and reshape us like a potter molding clay. We take those moments of tuning and reshaping and let them be turning points. Thank you once again for joining us for the Harmonizing the Body, Soul, and Spirit for Divine Worship Seminar. This has been day number 2, and I've enjoyed this time that we've had together. Come back again tomorrow for the final and the capping stone. Day number 3, when we discuss the most important element for all. And maybe you know certain parts of it, and maybe you don't. Maybe you know who God is, and maybe you don't. Tomorrow is for everyone. I don't care who you are. So I hope to see you back here once again. Thanks for joining us.